Of Amplify, it's a production by CU Engage, and it lets us know what students on campus are doing in the community. It bridges the college and the community. We'll find out more at 9 o'clock. Before that, we'll hear from Christian Picciolini about his new book, White American Youth, My Descent into America's Most Violent Hate Movement. That's coming up after commentary from Jim Hightower.
Multi-billionaire brothers Charles and David Koch want to supplant America's core democratic principle of majority rule, i.e. the will of the people, with their plutocratic principle of inviolable property rights, also known as rule by the wealthy minority. Their notion is that we the people cannot be allowed to tax the riches of the owner class, nor set rules on how they treat workers, consumers, and society as a whole. To set themselves up as the new American aristocracy, this clique of moneyed elites has been spending hundreds of millions of dollars, much of it secret, on front groups and whorish politicians. For nearly 40 years, they and their uber-rich allies have torn down legal structures and mechanisms that give ordinary people some chance to control their own destinies. The Koch's goals include killing all restrictions on political spending by corporations and the rich, suppressing voting rights of students, people of color, the elderly, and others who tend to favor democratic policies, eliminating labor unions, canceling the right of workers, consumers, and others to sue corporations that harm them, shredding the social safety net, including food stamps, Social Security, and Medicare, axing provisions to protect our environment, preempting the right of local people to pass laws that corporations oppose, and packing courts with pro-corporate judges. This is Jim Hightower saying, the Koch conspiracy's attack on our democratic rights has already rigged our country's economic and political rules so the richest of the rich can now grab ever more of our society's wealth and power, thus shattering America's commitment to the common good and creating a savage level of inequality in our land. To learn more, go to the watchdog group Center for Media and Democracy. They're at exposedbycmd.org/Koch.
What do the corporate powers from Wall Street to Walmart have in common? They hate the Hightower Lowdown. You can see why at www.hightowerlowdown.org.
Christian Picciolini is an unlikely peace activist. The musician and author is a former neo-Nazi who went on to co-found the non-profit peace advocacy group Life After Hate. He spoke with KGNU's Angela Palermo about his work and his new book, White American Youth, My Descent into America's Most Violent Hate Movement.
I think we as Americans are all aware that the election of Donald Trump has been problematic, to say the least, for a number of marginalized communities like immigrants or Muslims or the LGBT community. And his election seems to be part of a trend in particularly Europe, but other selected countries around the world like Egypt or the Philippines, this sort of move towards more fascistic or authoritarian rule. And democracy seems imperiled in the minds of many. So it's been a troubling trend for a lot of folks in the progressive community in general. And so this lurch to the right has been matched by a move to the left, and those segments have become energized and feel empowered and have definitely marshaled their forces in these last year or so, or a little over a year, since the election. What happens in the future seems to be up for grabs as far as the midterm elections in 2018 and then the next presidential election in 2020. So with me on the phone to discuss the past, present, and particularly the future of the far right and its opponents is Christian Picciolini. Christian is a former leader of neo-Nazi skinheads in Chicago, which was really the birthplace of that movement. Or perhaps I should say its rebirth, as the far right has long been a fixture on the American political scene, its fortunes rising and falling in concert with events both national and worldwide. Christian is the author of two related books, Romantic Violence, Memoirs of an American Skinhead, and White American Youth, My Descent into America's Most Violent Hate Movement and How I Got Out, which is sort of an updated version of Romantic Violence. As you can discern from the second subtitle, he left the white supremacist and neo-Nazi movements behind. Christian has done a complete 180, becoming a leader in efforts to combat racist groups in the United States and around the world. His media profile has greatly increased over the last year or so as the Trump phenomenon gained momentum and achieved power. You may have seen him on Democracy Now!, Samantha Bee's Full Frontal, Sarah Silverman's new show I Love America on CNN, on Face the Nation, and on Megyn Kelly's Today. So welcome, Christian, and thanks for taking the time to be on KGNU.
It's great to be here, Angela. Thank you so much.
I'm just so pleased that I was able to get you for this show. So getting started, I'm wondering if you might tell our audience a little bit about yourself. When and where did you grow up? Because I know that from reading the books that you moved within the Chicago area, and then that was really an important event for you.
Yeah, I grew up in the south side of Chicago in the 70s and 80s and 90s. I was a member at that point of America's first neo-Nazi skinhead group, which I joined at 14 years old in 1987. And I spent 8 years of my life until I was 22 as a member of that movement until I found my way out. I've stayed in Chicago. I'm based here now, and since having left the movement, I've been working to help dismantle it and help people disengage from it, probably for the last 18 years.
But you moved across town, which in the books is like this kind of very important episode, right?
Yeah. So as a young kid, and first of all, I think it's important to note my parents are Italian immigrants who came to the United States in the mid-60s. And they were often the victims of prejudice when they arrived. So, you know, racism wasn't a foundation of my upbringing. But after I was born, they moved us from the Italian neighborhood that we lived in across town to the suburbs to a very non-ethnic neighborhood where I was suddenly kind of the odd man out. Suffered a lot of bullying and ridicule and didn't have very many friends growing up, but I certainly had a lot of love at home. So my story isn't what someone would consider a typical story of broken home and going into a violent organization or becoming violent in any way. My issue was that growing up, I felt very marginalized, and I also felt very abandoned by my parents because while at the time I didn't know that they were just working hard, as a young kid I questioned why they were gone 7 days a week, 14 or 16 hours a day, and I often blamed myself for that. So I was always looking for a family or acceptance and a purpose.
I'm curious, what was the cultural and racial sort of environment in Chicago in the 80s when you were growing up? Chicago has long had a reputation of being a really racially divided city. Is that correct?
Chicago is still, to this day, one of the most segregated cities in America. And certainly growing up, there were neighborhoods that each had a flavor of the people that settled there. I grew up on the south side of Chicago in an Italian neighborhood where people from the same village that my parents came from had settled. And it was, a very old world Italian enclave that was sort of a bubble. But because my parents, after I was born, had moved us out of that neighborhood, I would only spend time in the Italian neighborhood while I went to school in a very non-ethnic neighborhood, a suburb that was essentially very WASPy. So I was, I didn't know what my identity was growing up. I didn't know if I was Italian. I didn't have any friends in that area. I didn't know if I was American because I didn't really have any friends at school. So I kind of floated in the middle and was feeling ostracized and marginalized because of that. So I really struggled for my childhood and into 14 years old with who I was and where I belonged and what my purpose in life was supposed to be. So I was very open to be seduced by someone who could fill those voids, eventually a pretty violent and extremist ideology.
You think those were the conditions that set you up for recruitment into the neo-Nazi movement?
I certainly think that there were other factors as well, like a lack of opportunity, not having positive guidance, living in and being raised in a neighborhood that was rapidly changing. I think it was a lot of factors. I call them potholes. Those are the things that appear in our life's journey that we have to navigate around or have enough resources to help us pull out of them. And sometimes if we don't have those resources or that guidance from people to navigate around them, we can get detoured down a very dark alley or sometimes get stuck. And that is when I think we're the most vulnerable because everybody is searching for an identity and a community and a purpose. Those are fundamental needs sometimes even more so than food and water. And I hadn't found that growing up until one day when I was 14 years old, and I was standing in an alley smoking a joint, and a man came up to me and he pulled the joint from my mouth and he looked me in the eyes and said, "That's what the communists and the Jews want you to do to keep you docile." I didn't know who this man was. He had a shaved head and he was wearing boots. It was 1987, so nobody in America really knew what a skinhead was. I certainly didn't. He enticed me with this feeling of acceptance. I didn't know what a communist or a Jew or even what the word docile meant at 14 years old, but it was as if he had thrown me a lifeline to belong. It didn't start out as racist. It was him kind of stoking my pride in being of European descent and filling me with all the facts of all the great heroes and warriors and thinkers that European heritage has produced. And then it would turn into, eventually, as I started to become more involved, that there were certain people who wanted to take that pride away from me. Specifically named groups of people like Jews or African Americans or immigrants or refugees as the problem and the people who were taking away my white identity. At that point, that was all I knew. I mean, it was the only thing that I had. So it was the fear rhetoric that he used made me very afraid to lose that as the only thing that I had at that point.
And you became a leader in the movement. And I don't want to dwell too much on that, but you became, within fairly short order.
By the time I was 16, I had essentially taken over the organization that I was recruited into, because the man who recruited me, who was America's first neo-Nazi skinhead leader, had gone to prison, as did several members, older members of this group. So responsibility for leadership kind of fell on me as the last man standing, if you will, and all the new recruits that had come after me. So I inherited it at a very young age and was able to have learned it from some of the earliest members of this movement from the very beginning.
You became the leader of two punk skinhead bands, White American Youth, which was the first group, and then which then broke up, and then Final Solution, the very ominously named second band. And,
correct.
You know, I know that that was kind of key to spreading the message of the neo-Nazi skinhead movement in Chicago and elsewhere. But I really want to now move on to, how did you get out? What drove you to get out? In the book, you talk about your doubts that you'd had all along. Can you start to tell us how you started to move yourself out, and what happened in your life? What life events happened that pushed you in that direction?
Yeah, and like you mentioned, I did have doubts throughout the 8 years I was involved, because, you know, it just wasn't part of my DNA. I wasn't raised that way. So, you know, there were moments of clarity that I had throughout. But my need for acceptance and for, you know, the perceived respect that I thought I was getting was more powerful. Essentially, throughout those 8 years that I was involved, and certainly more towards the end than at the beginning, I became more open to engaging with people that I had never brought into my social circle before. So, you know, anybody who was not white or who was gay, you know, I was more open to speaking with them, still very guarded. But what it boils down to, Angela, is I began to receive compassion and empathy from the people that I least deserved it from when I least deserved it. And these folks who I hated, or who I thought I hated, were willing to be compassionate towards me and give me a chance and try to engage in conversations that ultimately allowed me to humanize them. Because I had such a demonization in my head and such a prejudice of who these people were, and I'd never allowed myself to interact with them to understand who they were. That was what was driving my hatred, and ultimately turned into humanization after, you know, repeated attempts by people to try and reach me, and finally realized that I had more in common with the folks I thought I hated than I did with the people I surrounded myself with to boost my own ego, and became very confused and ultimately decided to walk away from it all and denounce my racism and prejudice.
If you're just joining us, you're listening to KGNU. I'm your host, Angela Palermo. Today we're speaking with Christian Picciolini. Christian is a former leader of a neo-Nazi skinhead group in Chicago. He's the author of two books, Romantic Violence and White American Youth. We've talked about you started to get out, and were there any key moments towards that end of the eight-year period of your involvement that really stand out?
Yeah, I mean, I think it really started to impact me when, at 19 years old, I met a girl who wasn't a part of the movement, coincidentally, and fell in love. And we had our first son at 19 and our second son at 21, and instantly it began to challenge my idea of identity, community, and purpose. You know, was I this hate monger, or was I a father and a husband? Was my community the one that I had manufactured around me, or was it the one I'd physically given life to? And was my purpose to destroy the world and everybody in it, because I was so angry and so self-loathing that all I wanted to do was project that onto other people? Or did I really want to create a safe and positive environment for my family? That was really the first time that I started to become very confused with a world I was very deeply committed to. At that point, I decided that I was going to pull back from the streets a little bit and decided to turn it into a business so that my family would be supported and be safer. And I opened a record shop. And it was at that record store that I sold white power music, and a lot of it. And in fact, it was 75% of my revenue at the store. But I also sold hip hop and punk rock and heavy metal. And when customers who came in to buy that, who were often, you know, Jewish or African American or Latino or gay, that's when I started to have those meaningful interactions with the people that for most of my life at that point, I had never had an interaction with. And it was those people who showed me the compassion that really touched me and helped me understand that what the life that I was living was a complete lie and destructive, not only to myself, but to the community around me.
So when you got out, you spent, according to the book, about 5 years sort of, if I might use the phrase, lost in the wilderness of depression and self-loathing. But then you started to turn your life around. You went to college, you got a degree, you went to conferences, and then it was in 2008, I believe, you first came out as being a former neo-Nazi skinhead leader. And then not long after that, in 2010-11, you formed a group called, an anti-hate group called Life After Hate. Can you tell our listeners more about that group and how it came to be and what sort of work you did?
You know, it all started towards the end of that five-year period that was a very dark period for me. I was treating other people with respect, but I just wasn't treating myself with respect. I didn't know who I was. I'd lost my wife and children in a divorce because I hadn't left the movement quickly enough. I'd abandoned the community the only other community that I'd known. And I just didn't know how to move forward. But a friend had convinced me to go apply for a job at IBM, even though I was completely unqualified for it. You know, I met a man there, an old security guard that I'd gone at my old high school, where IBM had placed me, coincidentally, as my first day of work to install their network and computer systems. This is a man who I tormented while I was at that school district, and he forgave me. He made me promise that I would tell my story, because he recognized how important it was, not just for somebody from who'd gone into a white supremacist group, but just for every young person who was really searching. And that led me in 2005, actually, to come out and denounce who I had been, because I had been running from it for so long. But in 2005 is when I started to really discuss my past openly. 2009, I co-founded an organization called Life After Hate, which at first was just a literary journal to try and tell our stories online, and very quickly realized that there were many more people like us around the world. And I changed the mission of Life After Hate at that point to really be one of service to people. So I have been running it up until just last year as an organization that helps people disengage from hate groups and hateful ideologies. And through that, I was able to help over 100 people disengage from hate groups.
How do you go about the work? And you mentioned potholes earlier. And how does that
Sure.
notion of potholes figure into the work that you did with Life After Hate?
That's a great question, Angela. Thank you. And what I do is really try and replicate the process that's worked on me almost 23 years ago. People typically will reach out to me for help in three different ways. So one will be the person who's looking for help for themselves and wants to disengage but doesn't know how or is perhaps worried about security. The other group is the bystander, could be a referral from a parent or a friend or a coworker. And then the third group is the former who managed to get out on their own but always thought that they were the only one that existed because they were too scared to talk about it. And I support them through a community, an online private community where other formers help each other. But when I start working with an individual, my goal is really very non-aggressive, and it's about building rapport and a lot of listening. I don't ever debate or argue or battle ideologically with anybody or tell them that they're wrong. Instead, I listen, and I listen very closely for those potholes. And I hear things like depression or trauma or unemployment or lack of social skills, and then I become a pothole filler. I try to enable people and empower them through resilience building, and that could be by having them work with a life coach or a mental health professional or even a tattoo removal service or a job trainer. Pretty amazing what happens when people become more self-confident, more resilient. They have less of a need to blame the other for the problems that exist in their lives. But I also do challenge them ideologically in a non-aggressive way, and that's by introducing them to the people that they think that they hate. So I've spent hours with Holocaust deniers and Holocaust survivors, Islamophobes and Muslim families and imams, and even homophobes and LGBTQ communities to try and foster that human connection and that humanization. It's been a very successful approach, and hopefully one that the average person can replicate just by showing people that they think are undeserving of compassion, that compassion and empathy, because I guarantee you that those people are the ones that need it the most.
Practical, logistical question. Does Life After Hate have chapters around the country, or is it more a centralized organization in Chicago?
Life After Hate is a centralized and a virtual organization at the same time. While it's based in the United States in the Midwest, there are affiliates who work within the network that are around the country, but there are no chapters per se. Folks are just based in different spots and service different areas.
And if one is obviously a former skinhead, you can get involved, or if you're still involved and trying to get out, or if you're a bystander, what if you're a bystander in the sense that you really don't know anybody, but you want to get involved? Is that possible too?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, you can certainly contact Life After Hate at their website, or you can contact me at my website, exitusa.org, which is the online portal for the disengagement work that I do.
That you've done.
Yeah,
you're now doing solo.
That I'm now doing solo.
Yeah, okay. So I have a question that's sort of very topical and very sort of clued into very recent events of the last, 6 months. How have the recent incidents of, say, the last 6 months or even a year affected you? I'm thinking about the racist anti-Semitic activity on the part of the far right, and it seems to me that the infamous events at Charlottesville, Virginia last August are perhaps the tip of a very ugly, repugnant iceberg. Would you say that's true, and if so, how?
Well, you know, this is something that's been ramping up for decades. You know, I believe that most of America felt we were living in a post-racial society as we made some progress and increments, and we elected an African-American president, and things seemed to be going fairly well. But the truth is that it never really went away. The cancer sort of metastasized. I mean, even 30 years ago, we recognized that we were turning away, we were being turned away by the average American racist who thought we were too edgy. So we decided at that point to tone down our image by adopting suits over boots and getting jobs in law enforcement and going to the military and then going to college campuses to recruit as well, because we recognized there were young, vulnerable people there who, you know, might be looking to join new communities, or who might have ideas about their purpose in life and were on their own for the first time. And I never really expected that it would ever take hold, but I believe that the election in 2016 really kicked the bucket of gasoline over on all those sparks that were smoldering, ignited up a massive fire that we're now dealing with. Charlottesville was a milestone event because not only did it put them, the far right, back on the map, so to speak, it also mobilized a lot of people to try and counter them, some with successful tactics and some with tactics that I wouldn't agree with or advise because I know how it emboldens them. But we're living in a time when this type of racism from 30 years ago that I was involved in has become normalized. And even though the packaging is different and maybe the message is more palatable in certain ways, the underlying theme is no different than the hateful, racist, xenophobic one that I was a part of 30 years ago.
And just to kind of wrap up, what do you see as the way forward for the anti-hate, anti-racist movement in the country or even worldwide? Considering your experience both within and outside a prominent hate movement, what, in your view, does that future look like? What should it look like?
Well, we need to be vocal, we need to be visible, and we need to be there and hold people accountable. But I caution two things. There are two things that extremists love, and it's specifically why they march in progressive areas like Berkeley and like Charlottesville. And that is, they love silence and they love violence. They know that if we are quiet and we're not talking about them, they have room to grow. They amass numbers based on misinformation and conspiracy theories. And if we're violent to them, then they use that against us as a counter-narrative, saying that they're the victim and that we are the haters and we're taking away their free speech. So there is a middle ground, and that is to be visible, to be vocal, and to be vigilant, but not to be violent, because they come to these areas with the intention of provoking violence that they then use as propaganda. And we see their numbers grow after every rally, after news media shows these incidents of violence, in some cases blames the protesters to the neo-Nazis, you know, as instigators, where in some cases that might be true, but certainly is a blanket statement that isn't true across the board.
Right. And Trump said the both sides argument that, you know,
exactly,
was so inflammatory to the progressive side of the spectrum.
Resistance movements have been an important part of fighting against authoritarian systems, and resistance movements are important. While I'm not a pacifist, I don't advocate violence at this time. You know, there is no need to fight on the streets against people who are marching, but it is important that we show that we're visible, that we're there, we come out in numbers to protest, and that we hold them accountable for their actions. And we can do that in very positive ways through legislation, by voting, by turning out when there's a need. And everybody has their tools. If you're a teacher, teach inclusion. If you're a musician or an artist, create art that is representative of our American culture as a whole and not just a certain segment of it. If you're a proud patriot, understand that while America is a nation of immigrants, it's also a nation of natives and ex-slaves. And until we can make that statement wholeheartedly, we're still putting forward a very privileged message. Just saying America is a nation of immigrants is a very white privileged statement. I think we need to look at our society and understand who it is we want to be as a nation and what our values are and if we've achieved them or if we haven't, and to really work towards that, because America should be a place where everybody has an equal footing, and in fact, those who may have been oppressed for some time might need a hand up.
Well, we've been speaking with Christian Picciolini. He is a former infamous neo-Nazi skinhead leader in Chicago and the author of the books Romantic Violence, Memoirs of an American Skinhead, and White American Youth, My Descent into America's Most Violent Hate Movement and How I Got Out. You may have seen him on a number of national TV shows and will likely see more of him in the coming months and years, as our world seems to have so many hate and terror groups of all stripes and in all parts of the globe. So, Christian, thank you so much for being on the show today. I really appreciate it.
Angela, thank you so much. It was a pleasure to be here.
And thanks to Angela Palermo for that interview. You can find out more information about Christian Picciolini online at kgnu.org. This is Community Radio, KGNU, Boulder, Denver, and Fort Collins. It's time now for Amplify.
Welcome to Amplify, stories of university community collaborations. I'm your host, Jennifer Siplett. Amplify is a production of CU Engage, the Center for Community-Based Learning and Research at CU Boulder, in partnership with Community Radio KGNU. The show aims to amplify the voices of students and community partners who are working together to generate new knowledge and ideas to tackle major public challenges. You can hear us on KGNU the fourth Wednesday of every month at 9 a.m. Or you can access the show archives by visiting www.colorado.edu/CUEngage. You can also hear bonus content where we continue the conversation, and you can learn more about today's topic by visiting the CU Engage website. On today's show, we are going to be talking about the Aquetza Summer Program, and I will be speaking with guests Magnolia Landa Posas and Jason Romero, who are the co-founders and co-directors of the Aquetza Summer Program. Also with us in the studio is Adriana Escorza, a current junior at Mead High School in Longmont and a two-time Aquetza Summer Program participant. Thank you so much. Welcome to the show. I'm glad you're here in the studio. So Magnolia, let me start with you. Can you just tell me a little bit about Aquetza, what it is and what the program is and what it aims to do?
Yeah, so Aquetza started 5 years ago now, in 2012. And it aims to bring high school students from throughout the state of Colorado to campus at CU Boulder and to envision themselves as holders of knowledge and active participants in academia. But also with the deep understanding that community knowledge and lived experience is equally important. So the idea is to be able to bring them onto campus to acknowledge that they're capable and able of being there. But the intent of bringing their families with them, right? And their community and their experiences. And also being able to share some of that knowledge back in their communities as well.
So Jason, when you were one of the co-founders of Aquetza, How did Aquetza start? Like, how was it born as an idea and then turned into a program?
Yeah. When I was a student at CU, a lot of us in UMAS y Mecha, the student organization, had been having conversations about the old UMAS programs, the summer bridge programs, the EOPs, everything that had been happening at the height of the Chicano movement at CU Boulder. And one day, myself and one of the other UMAS y Mecha students had just been talking, and we decided that, you know, we should try to resurrect those summer bridge programs and do something to bring people from around the state to campus, because we knew the university wasn't as actively engaged in doing that as they had been at one time. And so from that, we had just kind of started talking, and then we got with a group of other students in UMAS, including Magnolia and several others, and we decided on the name Aquetza, which is a Nahuatl or an Aztec word that means to lift your chin up. And that's what we decided to do, is go out and try to engage our community and help people from our community, people who were like us and like our families, to lift their chins up and be proud of who they were, to engage with both the university but also the community, and to solve those social issues that we were facing growing up and experiencing life in different places.
Awesome. And so do students come from all over Colorado, or where do high school students come from to participate in the Aquetza Summer Program, Magnolia?
They do come from all over Colorado. We've had people in the Western Slope, Denver metro area, up in Greeley, obviously Boulder County, Longmont, Boulder, San Luis Valley. We've had people in Pueblo as well.
And normally how many students come each summer for the program?
So when we first started, it was about 30 students, but for the last couple of years, it's been 40, around 40, 42.
40 students, and they stay on campus during the program. Is that right?
Exactly. They stay on campus for an entire week, and this year for 10 days, so we're really excited for that. But they stay on campus completely free, and all amenities provided.
Right on. Great. So, Adriana, I would like to ask you. So, you're a high school student in Longmont right now.
Yes.
Yeah, you're a junior. And you've done Aquetza for the last two summers. Is that right?
Yeah.
And you're doing it again this summer?
Hopefully. I put in my application.
Oh, you applied. I see. So can you tell me a little bit about how you found out about Aquetza and how you got involved in the program and what it's meant for you?
Yeah. So ninth grade year, my freshman year of high school, I was sitting in my integrated class, which is history and English. And I think a couple of the counselors from Aquetza came in and they talked about what the program was. At first, I was kind of confused, as are most students when they start Aquetza, like as to what's going to be going on when you get to the campus. So I was like, well, I have nothing to do this summer, so let me put in this application. And when I was filling it out, I was kind of like, you know, this seems like you're going to learn a lot about yourself and about the community you're in when you're applying to Aketsa. So when I got the call, I was accepted in. My mom had no idea I applied, and she was super excited. And I was confused as to what I was going to be doing. Especially being a freshman, you don't really, like, know what's going to happen. And you're kind of scared at first because it's college. Like, you're going to be on the campus. But Aketsa has changed my life completely for the better. I'm so knowledgeable about my culture, about my community, about my family, where I come from, who I am as a person. And it's really helped me find myself earlier in high school and who I was and who I wanted to be and what I wanted to bring to my school. It made me love education more. I was not a fan of school, but I'm like, you know, there's these stereotypes or there's pressures on people like me, who's a Chicana student. And Aketsa has helped me break through that and actually show the education system that I'm here and I can actually do things and participate. In my community, they're super proud of me. I've had several people that I've worked with in my community bringing that leadership into other kids and showing them what life's all about, what culture's about, what community's about. So it's helped me a lot.
And do you stay in touch with some of the people that you've met at Aketsa during the summer? Like, is there an element of it that's also just community among Chicano Latino students from around Colorado where that's important? Or is it more the content that you're learning in the classes about Chicano history, about Latino history that you learn in Aketsa? Or is it a combination of both? Like, what about it has made you feel more confident and more, you know, proud of your heritage and knowing more about that?
It's definitely both. That knowledge kind of helps me link together with the community that Aketsa is. Aketsa has become a family for me, and I know it has become a family for other students as well. Me being part of it for 2 years, I've actually gotten to work with more students and, like, be with them more. And I've learned more each year, and I keep growing from that knowledge. And those students that are all around Colorado, it's great to know that they're going to be taking the education that I just learned and everyone else learned and spreading that around. More people learn about Aketsa every year. When I see students that were like me, I educate them about it, and it really has become a sense of community. That knowledge that we're learning is so important, and it doesn't really happen within high school doors, I guess. There's a lot of education that's not taught there, but now there's a lot of students that are willing to bring it up, which just makes it grow into a bigger and bigger community.
So Jason, thinking about the Aketsa curriculum, how was the curriculum initially thought of? Like, what, you know, like you were saying, you know, you had this idea that it was going to be important to teach Chicano history and to teach, you know, Latino history in a context of Boulder and in a context of Colorado and in a context of the United States, right? So how did the pedagogy and the curriculum emerge, and how has it evolved over the past 5 years of programming?
Yeah, I mean, I think initially, like, what our goal was to bring Colorado's history to the forefront, talking about Los Seis de Boulder, talking about UMAS at the CU Boulder campus, talking about Ricardo Falcón, talking about the communities and the grassroots organizations that were doing this work during the Chicano movement. And luckily, growing up, I had met a few of the people who had been involved. And so they introduced me to other people. And so just while I was in college, I was kind of gathering my knowledge around the movement. And so when we had the opportunity to develop Aketsa, it became critical that Colorado's history was at the forefront. Because when we learn about civil rights, quote unquote, we talk about MLK. If we talk about Chicanos, Latinos, we talk about the United Farm Workers, but nothing else. And so we really wanted to bring that hidden history to the forefront. And so that's where kind of the content originated. In terms of the pedagogical approaches, those were really inspired by Freirean ideas, right? The pedagogy of the oppressed, the idea that students are holders and producers of knowledge, that our schools operate from a banking model of education, and our students need something more than that. If we want them to be critically engaged with the world, if we want them to think critically and understand what's going on around them. And so that became our pedagogical approach. And then over time, we began to root ourselves a lot more into indigenous approaches as well. So we began taking a look at, for example, the Mexican American Studies program that was banned in Tucson in 2010. And we started adopting the Nahui Olin, the four movements, as kind of the foundation of of what we do.
Can you say a little bit about some of that Chicano history in Boulder? You mentioned Los Seis. I think a lot of our listeners might be really interested in, you know, some of this content that the students are getting to learn about.
So UMA started in Boulder in 1968 with just a handful of Chicano students. And their first goal was parity. So they wanted to bring as many Chicano students onto campus as were present in the state. So for example, if there were like 15% Chicano Latinos in the state of Colorado, they wanted 15% of the student body at CU Boulder to reflect that. And so between 1968 and 1974, those numbers swelled from a handful to 1,400 students. And so this was an exponential explosion of Chicana students on the CU Boulder campus. In 1973 and 1974...
And just to interrupt for a second, just in case our listeners don't know, Chicano or Chicana, if I understand the term correctly, means you're from the U.S., you've grown up in the U.S., but of Mexican descent. Is that how you would define that?
For the most part. I mean, I think if you ask any Chicana or Chicano what a Chicana or Chicano is, you'll get a different answer every single time.
Yeah. Okay.
But for me, it's somebody who has ancestry that is, and it doesn't even necessarily need to be Mexican. For example, my family is from northern New Mexico, and we've been there forever. When that was indigenous land, somos indios. When that was Mexico, somos mexicanos. When that was the United States, we became Americans. We've always been there. And so that's why I identify myself as Chicano. For other people, it's a Mexican-American. It kind of depends on who you ask. So in 1973 and 74, there were different instances on campus where students had to engage in more direct political actions. There were sit-ins at Regent Hall and then a building occupation at temporary building number one in 1974. And in 1974, two cars exploded. There were two car bombs that went off. The first at Chautauqua Park on May 27th, 1974. That killed Neva Romero, who is currently an UMA student, Reyes Martinez, who was going to law school, and Una Jacola, who is a recent CU graduate. Less than 24 hours later, there was a second car bomb. Killed three more students, Florencio Granado, Heriberto Terán, and Francisco Doherty. A fourth individual, Antonio Alcantar, was injured in that explosion, but did survive. And so collectively, those six individuals who were killed in 1974 within 48 hours are known as Los Seis de Boulder. And within UMAS y Mecha and activist circles in Colorado, we kind of look at Los Seis de Boulder as symbols of resistance, as people who are fighting for our community to advance in a variety of ways, and who unfortunately lost their lives as a direct result of their political activism.
Do we know anything about who set the bombs?
No, I mean, that's kind of like the greatest mystery about Los Seis, is there's never been any evidence that proves what happened at those two scenes. I mean, there's theories. You ask different people, you ask police, you ask community members, you're always going to hear different stories. But there's no hard evidence that says this is clearly what happened.
Adriana, so when you learned this, did you learn about Los Seis and this history in Boulder County for the first time when you were at Aquetza?
Yes.
So how did that impact you? So you must have been then, you know, 14 or 15 years old as a freshman in high school from Longmont, and you're learning about this kind of local history and Chicano movement for the first time. How did that impact you?
At first, I guess I was kind of upset at the fact that you never really learn about this history, and you never really get to hear about it in school and stuff like that. It kind of upset me because, like, I think when you're going through high school and even middle school, you're just kind of lost as to who you are and what your community is. My mom is actually white and my dad's Mexican. So I never really knew I was Chicana because, like, no one was ever like, well, that's what you identify as. You know, I learned that at Aquetza. So when I'm finding out that there's students like that that are fighting for students like me, and even if it was beforehand, it's kind of my job and other students' job to keep carrying on that activism and actually going out there and speaking about the problems, because although those students died and were obviously murdered, it doesn't mean that they actually got what they wanted. It's still a continuous fight to get those rights that they were working for. And so much to so, like, it's such a big event that not many people know about, such as myself, that it didn't even really get the message across in what their message was, and it still needs to be spread. So for me, it gave me that sense of leadership and that sense of community once again to go back and teach that knowledge to people in my community as well.
You are listening to Amplify, Stories of University Community Partnerships. This show is a production of CU Engage at the University of Colorado Boulder in partnership with Community Radio KGNU. You can hear our show on the fourth Wednesday of every month at 9 a.m. Amplify aims to raise the voices of students and community partners who are working together to generate new knowledge and ideas to tackle major public challenges. Right now, today, I am in the studio with our guests, Magnolia Landa Posas and Jason Romero, who are the co-founders and co-directors of the Aketza Summer Program at CU Boulder, which is a program of CU Engage. And we are also joined by Adriana Escorza, a current junior at Mead High School in Longmont and a two-time Aketza Summer Program participant. Magnolia, I wanted to turn it back to you. As you have gone through, because you just graduated last year, and now I know you're working with CU Engage with the Just Transition Collaborative as well. During the 4 years that you were a CU Boulder student and directing the Aketza Summer Program, what did it mean for you to be able to incorporate this into your CU Boulder experience as a student, and then now as a staff member at CU Boulder? How is it meaningful for you to continue this work?
So in high school, I was a very high-achieving student, and then I came to Boulder. I was like, I got this, I'm going to kill it, I'm going to do great. But isolation is real. And I think that's something that I was never taught in high school, was that there's such thing as cultural shock. So I was born and raised in Aurora, Colorado, and I went to a high school that was predominantly Mexicano, Black, African-American. So when I came to CU, it was a completely different cultural experience. And I felt like I had no family and really felt like I did not belong on campus. And I was experiencing that as someone that ideally was like the perfect candidate for college. So my grades went down. I wasn't doing great. And I was actually highly considering leaving CU Boulder. But I think part of what kept me there is that I am the oldest in my family. And there's like a certain degree of like, you can't leave and leave that as kind of the legacy for your siblings to look up to. So in an effort to like find community, I found Umasimecha. And they were essentially the people and the folks on campus that reminded me that I mattered, that I was valued. And in part, knowing the history was essential to that, right? Understanding that others before me struggled just as much, if not more, and had put in a lot of effort for even me to be able to be on campus. And so it's that reminder that I needed to pull through and follow through with college and graduate and finish. And it was all Aketza, right? It's that idea of like Aketza, hold your chin up, be with community. And then now that I'm graduated, I think a lot of my motivation in my work is remembering that community is important. And it's recognizing that our community has knowledge that is valuable, and that we have a lot of things to offer to society, right? And not that we're just deficit or need help. So I think that's really centered the work that I do, and keeping in mind the importance of doing grassroots efforts. And working within academia and acknowledging that that's valuable, but not letting it be the only thing that drives you.
And I also, you know, just want to bring this back a little bit to our national political context right now. I mean, during the course of the time that Aketza has been functioning, right, there's been, you know, several things that have happened. You know, one, we moved from an Obama presidency to a Trump presidency. You know, 2012, DACA was signed into law, and I believe Aketza was new then. Sure. That was your first year when DACA was signed into law. So, which I would imagine for Aketza. So if you're bringing high school students, you know, Latino Chicano high school students from all over Colorado to campus to do Aketza, and suddenly there is a new possibility through the ASSET program in DACA where potentially they can get a work permit and they can go to university and they can apply legally to attend college. Whereas before 2012, that was maybe not an option for certain undocumented youth, that could have you know, been something that also changed during the time that Aketsa has been operating. And then now with the election of 2016 and the Trump administration also, you know, making changes to cancel DACA and the whole immigration debate on the national scale, I'm wondering how some of these national contexts have interplayed with Aketsa, with the development of curriculum, with shaping or influencing the way that you talk about Chicano history in this, you know, in this current context, in this moment.
Like you said, a lot has happened over the past few years. And I mean, I think that's definitely colored the experience of Aketsa. But one thing that we try to do is not so much focus only on the political climate that exists today, because for our communities, that's what it's been forever. Since 1848 and my family became American citizens overnight, like that's what our experience has been. And so like recognizing that, yeah, I mean, there's these waves where things are going to improve. And like, yeah, DACA gave a lot of people hope. And I would argue that probably helped encourage a lot of undocumented students who come to our program to apply. But once we get there, it becomes much larger than just what's happening now, because we have to locate ourselves within a historical context as well. And so understanding that this has been happening, and right now where we are, this is the current iteration of everything that's played out. I think that's critically important for our young people to understand, because I mean, the struggle isn't going to end when Trump's out of office. The next person, whether they're Democrat or Republican, we're still going to be dealing with the same problems. And so for me, it's about inspiring that desire to change the community, because that's where change happens, right? When it's our families that begin to have conversations and we change within ourselves, then like a seed, right? It germinates from underneath. It's not change that comes from above that, you know, dictates how our lives are going to be. It's how we grow and develop from the ground, because I mean, the world that we live in right now, I mean, we're almost already in the ashes, you know? So it's about how are we going to grow something beyond that?
And Adriana, how do you see this playing out in your high school in Longmont? Like do you notice a difference, for example, from kids who have this sort of context and sort of knowledge that you have and kids who have not gone through a program like Aketsa or aren't sort of interested in creating those seeds that Jason's talking about in the community? And how do you bridge that gap?
It's hard to bring up the education that I'm taught at Aketsa during school, which it primarily would come up during a history class, sometimes an English class. I've dealt with having that knowledge a little harder sometimes, but sometimes I think you have to know how to deal with it. You have to know how to deal with having such a strong knowledge about stuff and such a powerful facts that you have in your hands. You have to know how to deal with that. And I think Aketsa has taught me how to deal with that very well. At my school, I go to a primarily Latino and white school. So there's no African-American students at all. That's the two races that are there. And it's very hard to coexist for some reason. Because I think that a lot of people have beliefs from their parents. And Aketsa teaches you to think for yourself, to think how you feel, to think through your family, like, and what you've been taught from, like, your culture and stuff like that. And I think that me having that knowledge helps me show other kids that it's okay to respect one another's beliefs, but sometimes you just have to listen. And sometimes you just have to hear them out. Like Hassan said, we try to go away from the political aspect. I see that a lot in Aketsa, because it's hard to focus on politics all the time when there's people that are suffering from more than just politics or not being heard or not getting the same education. Like, it's not always about who's elected or who's the president. Sometimes it's about where you're at and who you plan on being and what message you plan on providing in your community. I say this for a lot of the students at my school, you know, we have to graduate, you know, like Chicanos, Chicanas, like we have to do it because we have to show them, you know, like we have to break the barriers that are there down, and not everybody gets to do that. So I like to implement things such as our Latino Leadership Club. And I like to tell them about the education in the Quetzal so they can go out and spread that in the school. It helps a lot and it makes our community grow even bigger. And it educates those students who don't know whether they are Chicano, Chicana, African-American, whatever race they are. At least they have this knowledge of how these students may feel and how to go out and impact their own community.
And Magnolia, I will ask the last question to you. How does, if there's parents listening or students listening who might be interested in coming to a Quetzal and joining the summer program and doing these 10 days on campus at CU Boulder, I don't know, is the application process still open? Is it closed? How can people find out more about a Quetzal or apply to be involved?
For this year, our application is open up until May 5th. And they can find our application. It's online, www.colorado.edu/Aquetza. You'll find it. Go to the About Us page specifically.
Great. We'll also link to it from the Amplify page as well.
So. Yeah. So that's how they go about applying. We accept students in high school, generally mostly focused around 9th through 11th graders, but also open to 12th graders. And really what it's looking like for this year, it would be a 10-day commitment from July 13th all the way through July 22nd. They do stay on campus. And a question that parents often ask is like, so where are people sleeping? They're in the dorms. Male-identified and female-identified are separate. I know that's a big question oftentimes in our communities. And then, I mean, we're always willing and able to work with our families. If there's a need for transportation, we find it. We can pick students up. If there's a need for us to have a dialogue with parents before the program, to have an intimate conversation about what it means for them to be away from their students for 10 days and the impact that it could have on their academics, then we could do that too. So we're always open to building relationship beyond just our students with families as well in English and Spanish. So that's something really exciting.
Thank you all so much for being here. I hope that people will check out more about the Quetzal Summer Program. My last question, because I know that some of our listeners might have questions about this, where does the funding for Quetzal come from?
We get funding from a lot of different sources. Most of those are from the CU School of Education, Odyssey, again on the CU Boulder campus, the Office of Diversity, Equity, and Community Engagement. We apply for different grants throughout the year. We do fundraising through the UMA student group on campus, the Bueno Center at the School of Education.
We also get some donors, private donors, people that have done in the past, parents, community members, obviously CU Engage. But we're always looking for people.
Thank you so much for being here. Really, really appreciate you all coming in. Amplify is a production of CU Engage, the Center for Community-Based Learning and Research at CU Boulder, in partnership with Community Radio KGNU. The show aims to amplify the voices of students and community partners who are working together to generate new knowledge and ideas to tackle major public challenges. You can hear our show on KGNU the fourth Wednesday of every month at 9 a.m., or access the show archives by visiting www.colorado.edu/CUEngage/Amplify. Thank you so much for listening, and we'll see you next month.
You are tuned into KGNU, Boulder, Denver, and Fort Collins. You're listening to the Morning Sound Alternative. My name is Indra. Glad to be with you on this beautiful Wednesday morning. Man, the weather has really been throwing us all over the place lately. I was walking my dog this morning and there was frost on all of the cars, and I went to put him inside and do a couple things for 10 minutes. I go outside. All the frost is gone. Within minute. Within minute. Within minute.